Well, I am eternally grateful tonight for this bigger pulpit, because when you get to my age, you need something to lean on. So, you know, I have my notes, I have my Bible, and sometimes they just give you a little narrow podium, and so that really becomes problematic. But it's really an honor for me to stand behind this pulpit, because this is the original pulpit in this congregation, so 100 years old. It's good to see you tonight, and thank you so much for the invitation of being with you. I hope that what I am going to be sharing with you tonight will be a great blessing to your life. My daughter said to me, I think it was yesterday, she said, "Now, Dad, you have to wear a Hawaiian shirt tomorrow night, the 36th Street." And I said, "What?" "You have to wear a Hawaiian shirt, said Anna Hart called me and told me to make sure that I got the message. So last night I had to go shopping, and I'm going to tack that incidentally onto the bill for tonight to get this shirt. I said, "Where did this come from?" And so I'll let Mike Moss know. Thank you very much, brother, for that tradition at the 36th Street Church. Tom Butterfield and I, we are of that era where you did not preach unless you were dressed up. Y'all remember those days? I'll tell you what, in my early days of my preaching career, I always wore a shirt, tie, suit to the office every day. Never made a visit unless I was dressed in a suit. And of course, at Belpre, they got to the point, they asked me one day, they said, "So do you do your gardening in a suit?" And I said, "Well, no, I don't do my gardening in a suit." And so I've really had to learn in my old age what it looks like to dress down. And so I'm dressed down tonight. Well, so much. Thank you again for having me. When Terry called me and asked me to come, I said, "Well, what are my choices?" And most of the other preachers had taken most of the choices. And so I said, "Well, let me do the Passover." And I hope that tonight that you will leave here perhaps thinking on a little bit deeper level than you have thought about the Passover. See, typically we say, "Well, yes, when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, they were eating the Passover." The Passover occurred in the land of Egypt. And it's sort of superficial. Probably have not taken the time to sit down and really spiritually analyze the Passover and its significance. So let me begin. The story of the Passover is the story about the wonderful words of life. And I may say this several times tonight, this is the wonderful words of life. The Passover was celebrated every year by every Jewish family. The trip was made to Jerusalem to remember how God had delivered them from Egyptian bondage. In the second chapter of the Gospel of Luke, verses 41 and 42, the Bible says that every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When Jesus was 12 years old, they attended the festival as usual. I would ask you tonight, have you done the math? How many Passover festivals did the Lord Jesus Christ attend? Now, obviously from the age of 12 to his baptism in the River Jordan, We have the silent years, and so we're not told what happened in those years. But Jesus Christ grew up in a typical Jewish family. And so before we come to our text tonight, Jesus Christ, in all probability, had attended 21 Passover feasts. And so the last one is when he is 33 years of age. He comes to make the ultimate sacrifice for our sins as our Passover. And so the text for tonight's message is found in Luke chapter 22, verses 14, 15, and 16. Look at these with me. When the hour came. You see, Jesus throughout his ministry had been saying to his disciples, my hour has not yet come. But as we come to these final moments, he says, the hour came. He reclined at table and the apostles with him, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. But I say to you, I shall not eat again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Jesus eagerly desires to eat the Passover with the disciples before he suffers. The story of the Passover, it retells. It is a reliving every year of the Passover lamb that was sacrificed. And so during those precious moments in that upper room, gathered around the table, Jesus Christ with these 12 men, they retell, they relive the story of the Passover. They remember the time when the nation of Israel was a nation of slaves in Egypt. They remembered the time when God had raised up Moses and he was to go and deliver the people out of Egyptian bondage. It was a time that they remembered the plague of death and the plague of judgment that God brought on the land of Egypt. Plague after plague, 9 of them in total. And each of those plagues, Pharaoh simply hardened his heart. He said, no, you are not free to go. But then finally, God brings the 10th plague. And as I said, this is a plague of death. It is a plague of judgment on Pharaoh and upon the Egyptians, and God's people at this moment are going to be set free. Listen to me tonight. Set free after 400 years plus of bondage and slavery. My dear friends, those are the wonderful words of life. By God's sovereign design, the feast of the Old Testament, established in Leviticus chapter 23, contain a prophetic shadow of God's redemptive plan for mankind. I think many times we study the Old Testament Jewish feast days, but then we fail to see that those feast days are a shadow of God's redemption for mankind that is going to become a reality in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we're going to see tonight in the Passover a picture of the Messiah's death, our Passover, one. We're going to see how that there is a deliverance in our lives from the bondage of sin. And so by design, it was at Passover that the Lord Jesus Christ was to be crucified. And so in this message tonight, I want to draw parallels. I want us on the one hand to look into Exodus chapter 12 and see here is the story. But then I also want us to draw a parallel from the story that we're reading as we see that in the New Testament. Now notice in our text, Jesus told his disciples, I shall not eat the Passover again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. What is Jesus saying? I think that Jesus is simply saying, I shall never eat it again until the typical symbolical meaning of the Passover has become fully realized in the kingdom of God. And so I suggest to you tonight that the real meaning of the Passover can be seen in the present day kingdom of God. But I will also suggest that it even goes further than that into the glorified kingdom of God that is yet to come. So, the deliverance of God's people, not from Egypt, but from all sin and evil, will be accomplished, now get this, in the kingdom of God. It is in the kingdom of God that we are going to be fully redeemed. Are you redeemed tonight? The answer to that is yes. Are you going to be redeemed? The answer to that is yes. And so there is a fulfillment of the realization of the meaning of the Passover in the kingdom today. But there's also, because I am going to be fully and totally redeemed when the Lord Jesus Christ comes a second time. So the Passover and the Exodus foreshadows a future deliverance and redemption for all of those who believe in God through Jesus Christ. And so this shows for us that God is for us and not against us. So in preparation for his crucifixion, Jesus, as a member of the Jewish community, eats this Passover meal with his disciples. So you have your Bibles. Open your Bibles tonight to the 12th chapter of the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter number 12. On the overhead projection, I'm going to project the verses that I will be alluding to, and you can follow that in your Bible. So let's begin. I'm in Exodus chapter number 12, and I want you to look at the very beginning. So here is the first point. Every household was to select an unblemished lamb, a sheep or a goat. Now listen to this. On the 10th day of the first month, and the lamb was to be killed on the 14th day of the month. And so here we are. We're in the city of Jerusalem and it's Passover. A lamb has to be selected. It is selected on the 10th day of the first month. The first month being the beginning of the Jewish year. But that lamb is not going to be killed until the 14th day of the first month. The selection of that animal was to be unblemished, but it had to be 1 year old male. So a one-year-old unblemished male is going to be sacrificed. Well, you say, what's that mean? That simply means that they could not bring a baby lamb. No, it was a lamb that was full grown and in the very prime of life. If you were a poor Jewish family and you could not provide a lamb, then you could join a neighbor and you could share a Passover lamb together. Parallel. Are y'all listening? Jesus Christ enters Jerusalem. Exactly 4 days later, from the time that he enters Jerusalem, he is crucified as our Passover lamb. He is not sacrificed as our Passover lamb when he was a baby. No, he is a male, full grown, and in the very prime of his life when he makes the ultimate sacrifice. And so you see, it was by God's design, very precisely, exactly, that Jesus Christ would enter the city of Jerusalem. He is selected as our Passover lamb, and 4 days later, he will be crucified. Next point. The blood of the lamb was put on 2 doorposts on the lintel of the houses in which the Passover meal was to be eaten. We're at verse number 5. This is extremely significant. So the Passover lamb is killed. But the blood of that lamb, where does the blood of the lamb go? The blood of the lamb goes on the house where the Passover meal is going to be eaten and over where the family must remain. And so the blood is put on the doorpost on the lintel. Therefore, that house becomes a house of refuge. It is the house of refuge because it is the house with the blood on it. It is a place of protection, and it is going to be the place from which rescue will be made from slavery. Parallel. Our refuge is found only in the Lord Jesus Christ. And guess where we are? We are in God's house. Now, when I talk to you tonight about God's house, I'm not talking about this building that we're in. You understand, don't you? And so the blood of the sacrificed lamb is on the house. And every family must remain in the house. Verse number 8. The Passover lamb was to be roasted with fire. I want you to stop and think about this. Is there a parallel to this lamb? The whole lamb is taken. You'll find later here in the 12th chapter that not a single bone of the sacrificial lamb was broken. And so this lamb is roasted, and then the lamb is eaten. I am suggesting to you tonight that Jesus Christ, our Passover lamb, was roasted. You say, what in the world do you mean by a statement like that? I believe that he was roasted physically and spiritually, and the agony was beyond description. In the Gospels, Jesus Christ referred to his suffering as a baptism. That simply means that Jesus Christ was totally immersed in agony, in pain, and in suffering. The physical involved scourging, beating, the crown of thorns, and the nails that were driven through his hands and his feet. However, it was not just physical agony. No, it was spiritual agony also. You see, it was spiritual agony because our Passover, our Lamb of God, took our sins into his own body and endured for us the ultimate of punishment. Because you see, when he took our sins into his body, he was then separated from God. And he cries out on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? But as you read the writings of Peter, you learn that he was punished for us. And that simply means that he suffered the punishment of hell. And then in verse number 8, we also learn the Passover lamb was to be eaten with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Leaven in the Bible symbolizes different things, including evil, corruption, and sin. And so I'm suggesting to us tonight that when the Passover lamb was eaten, it was eaten with sincerity and purity of heart. But not only was it eaten with unleavened bread, and incidentally, you also learned here in Exodus chapter 12 that it was necessary for every Jewish family to purge out of their house all leaven. But it was also eaten with bitter herbs. The bitter herbs, because it was a time when the Israelites remembered the bitterness of their slavery, those terrible, awful, horrible days that they spent as slaves in the land of Egypt. What's the parallel? I'm suggesting that as they ate the Passover lamb, that we, as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are to ingest spiritually Jesus Christ. As followers of the Lord, when we come to the table of the Lord in the kingdom of the Lord to eat in memory of his body and his blood, it is a time for us to remember the bitter days when we were living in sin, when we were in spiritual bondage. But it is also a wonderful time for us to remember our deliverance that came through Jesus, our Passover, from the bondage of sin. I want to ask you a question. Who was invited to eat the meal? Have you thought about that? Well, every circumcised Israelite, every native-born Israelite had the privilege of eating at the table this Passover meal. But in Exodus chapter 12, beginning with verse number 43 and through verse 49, let me tell you what you learn. You learn that foreigners, strangers, and slaves who had been circumcised were invited to eat the Passover meal. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Because you see, no uncircumcised person was excluded from the Passover meal. Today, every baptized believer is invited to the table of the Lord. Those are wonderful words of life. Every one of us tonight, as baptized believers, we can come and we can eat at the table of the Lord, remembering our sacrifice lamb as we partake of the body and the blood of our Lord. Next, in verse number 11, we learn that this meal was eaten in haste, immediately without delay, because they were going to leave the house of bondage and they were going to start that journey to the promised land. Oh, it's so important that immediately, without haste, right now, that all of us embrace the Lamb of God that takes away our sins, our Passover lamb. Verse number 11 also, and also verse number 42 in Exodus 12. The Passover, now this is significant. The Passover meal was the Lord's Passover. It's the Lord's Passover. Notice this verse with me, verse 42. It is a night to be observed for the Lord. For having brought them out of the land of Egypt, this night is for the Lord to be observed by all the sons of Israel throughout their generation. Oh, it was a feast. It was a time in which everyone in the nation was involved. But it's the Lord. It was the Lord's Passover. So where is the focus? The focus is on God. That's where the focus is in the Passover. It's about what he has done. It is God that delivers. It is the focus of his might and of his power. God is the one who brought freedom. God is the one who is the answer to our problem of bondage. Jesus Christ is the one who delivers us from the bondage of our sins. Let's come to verse 13. The night of the Passover, God will go through the land of Egypt, fatally strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. Notice verse 12 with me. For I will go through the land of Egypt on that night and fatally strike all firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the human firstborn to animals, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute death. I am the Lord. So God at midnight is going to pass over the land. He's going to strike with death and with judgment. When is it that Jesus and the disciples are eating the Passover meal? It's the night before his crucifixion. Many Bible scholars are of the opinion that it could very well have been at midnight, the exact time that the Lord passes over the land of Egypt, that Jesus Christ leaves the upper room to make his journey to the Garden of Gethsemane. Now I want you to notice the next verse. When I see the blood, or you need to underscore that. When I see the blood, that's a key phrase in this whole story. The blood shall be a sign for you on the house where you live. I want you to get that. It's where you live. It's where you're staying. You're not going to leave the house. No, the blood is on it. When I see the blood. What is God going to do when he sees the blood? He says, I'll pass over you. And no plague. No plague will come upon you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. When I see the blood, listen to me carefully. When you are in the house with the lamb's blood on it, you will never be destroyed. In this case, death did not strike those in that house. Tonight, all of us can be assured that we will never be touched by the second death. So that's the story. It's a wonderful story. It's a story about slavery. It's a story about love and grace. It's a story about deliverance. It's a story about freedom. It's a story about the beginning of a new life. And so tonight I want to ask, what is the application for today's church? How long do I have? When do we leave here?
About 7:45, roughly.
We leave at 7:45? Well, that's a problem. Okay. Pardon me? Paul preached till midnight. You don't want me doing that either. Okay. Now, let me real quickly. I want to give you these points to think about. Christ is our Passover. He's our Passover. Why is that so significant? Because Jesus Christ was totally unblemished. He never committed a sin in his whole life. He lived a perfect life. He did what I could never do. He did what you could never do. And the book of Hebrews, the Bible says that when he was a son, that he learned obedience, and I'm paraphrasing it, but his obedience made him perfect, and his becoming perfect, he became the source of our salvation. And so when I become an obedient follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, according to Paul's teaching in the fourth chapter of the book of Romans, the perfection, the obedience, the righteousness of Jesus Christ is imputed on my account. Another lesson. We must be in the house, the church, with the blood on it. So the house of God is the church of God. And you remember that the Apostle Paul says this as he writes to Timothy in 1 Timothy 3:15. But in case I am delayed, I write to you that you will know how you should act in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. But you see, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ was purchased with his blood. And we learned that in Acts chapter 20 and 28. And so here we are tonight, followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have come into a spiritual relationship with God through our Passover lamb. And we are in God's house. And it's God's house that has the blood on it. And the next thing, tied very closely, when God sees the blood, our sins are forgiven. Now, I want you to stop and think about this. Go back for a moment with me to your baptism. What happened in your baptism? In your baptism, you were baptized into Jesus Christ. But you were also baptized into his death. Romans 6 and 3. And so in your baptism, what was it that cleansed you? The blood of Christ. Who was it that cleansed you? It was Jesus Christ, our Passover lamb. And then we think a bit further. It's been 73 years now since I was baptized. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus cleanseth us from all sin. That verb, cleanse, is a linear verb in the Greek text, and that simply denotes continual action. The blood of Christ flows 24/7. The blood of Christ washed me and cleansed me in baptism. But as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, I've died to sin. I'm a person of repentance. I'm a person of confessing my sin. I'm a person of prayer. I'm a person walking and living in the light. Guess what? The blood of Jesus is cleansing me daily of the sins that I commit. Life is in the blood. Leviticus 17:11. Well, finally, Christ, our Passover, calls us to live holy lives. Let me share these verses with you from 1 Corinthians 5. Clean out the old leaven so that you may be a new lump, just as you are in fact unleavened. For Christ our Passover also has been sacrificed. Therefore, let's celebrate the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. We know the context, do we not? A man in the Corinthian church was living with his father's wife. Here's the challenge tonight. All of us need to become a new lump, a new person in Jesus Christ. But to do that, there is the casting out of the leaven. Since Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us, we tonight are to clean out the old leaven and we become a new person in Jesus Christ. I suggested to you tonight that the Passover in Egypt began on the first month of the Jewish calendar, and we began a new life in Jesus Christ when we are born again. So, conclusion. The wonderful words of life are words of redemption, words of forgiveness, words of freedom from sin. They're words of hope, because Jesus is our Passover. If you're not a child of God tonight, we invite you to place your faith and your trust in the Lord. Be ready to come and confess your faith and then to walk into the waters of baptism, to be buried into Jesus Christ and into his death, and for your sins to be washed away and to God to give you new life. If you need prayer for any reason in your life, we invite you to respond as together we stand and sing.